Hello YouTube viewers, welcome to my show Future Friday. In today's episode, we're gonna continue our moon series, and now we're gonna take a look at how do we get power on the moon. So let's dive right into it. Now, before we understand power, we have to understand what are the need for it. Like, why do we need power in the first place? Now, the most important one is life support and communication. Like, if humans go there in the first place, we're gonna make sure that they survive there. To make sure they survive there, we have to have temperature regulation, we have to have air scrubbers, we have to have communication so they don't lose their mind. All things combined, we're gonna need energy for that. Then once we get that, I'm talking about colonizing the moon, not going there for a trip or so, it's just to colonize the moon, to actually extract wealth out of it. We're gonna need industrialization, and all industry, as you can see, takes energy and lot of it. So this stage itself is not very easy. It's a very energy intensive process. And on top of that, once we get the energy, like once we have the life support going on, once we have the energy to industrialize, we also need energy to do orbital launch. Now you may be like, why don't use rocket? First, rocket use propellant. Now even in low gravity environment of, let's say, moon, your rocket is still not 90% payload and only 10% fuel. It's still much bigger proportion. Now proportion change based on the design and specific impulse of the engine. The thing remains that you are expelling a lot of propellant every time you have to send up. Now when we are talking about industrial scale, I'm talking tons and tons, hundreds of tons per day. Rocket simply won't be able to do that. I mean, like, you can do that, but you will be wasting a lot of propellant. So a maglev will work flawlessly for that, and we need roughly 8,000 to 9,000 kilometers per hour. Now you might be like, okay, that's very fast. Even though maglev can go that fast, that's difficult. It's difficult on Earth, not on Moon, for two core reasons. A, the vacuum nature of the Moon itself allows you to travel very far. Second, due to low gravity, the weight of the material that you are sending is not as much as it would be on Earth. So when I say a ton, I'm talking about ton on Earth. Ton on Moon is not a ton. It's very little, very less. So these two things combined, you can make sure a maglev goes very fast without needing ludicrous amount of power. It will still need power, but won't be ludicrous. So that way we can transport material from our mining operation to orbit for manufacturing or colonization of Venus very effectively and easily. And this will not require sort of continuous supply of propellant. So these are the three core reasons why we need power. Now of course there are other things also, but these are the main factors. Then we come to what are our options. Now we have RTGs, then we have solar panel, and then I have my personal solar thermal dishes. So let's look into them one by one. Now first thing, RTGs. Now RTG is the definition of simplicity. It's very simple. You have a material, a radioactive material that is decaying very fast, as in it's instead of decaying over millions of years, it's decaying over let's say 80 year period. So using RTGs we can extract power. However, the fact remains that it is very low power. Now what I mean by low power is like RTG that is on the Curiosity rover, the RTG that was sent on the moon, none of these things have like kilowatts of power, none of them. Like if you have the same mass in terms of your solar cell, you will get much more power out of it. These are not power intensive. However, this will make a perfect power source for life support system, where you don't want to risk it, because you can bury it, you can be sure like nothing happens to it. Solar cell can be covered by dust, can be damaged by micrometeoroid, and compromise the safety of the crew. RTGs don't have to worry about that. You can bury the RTG very deep and be like absolutely certain they're gonna work. And RTGs generally have a working lifespan of 20 to 30 years, which we have already tested. It's not something made up. We tested it. We know how it's gonna work. So RTGs will be playing a very crucial role. Not nuclear reactor, because nuclear reactor have way too many red tapes, and it has a very serious risk of blowing up. Now even though with space technology we'll have less risk of blowing up, but it still could happen if mismanaged. I'm not talking about malice, I'm talking about mismanagement. So RTGs will play a crucial role, but not nuclear technology. That NASA's kilowatt reactor, we can send it there and it could be good help at the beginning phases, but at the towards the final industrial phase, it will not provide enough power for us. So RTG is a good starting point. then we come to solar panels, and many of these sort of design concept has been floating around the internet, where you're gonna cover the equator of moon and send power to Earth. I have already made a video about solar power from space. You can check it out here. So this is really not that efficient, and the fact that we are interested into it is simply because it's very simple, it has no moving parts, and it's very powerful. It exceeds the power of RTG and even the power of a nuclear reactor, not by a lot, be mindful, not by a lot. And it's a distance dependent. So basically, if you are, let's say, going further, like going to Mars, solar panels lose any effectiveness, although on moon they are quite effective. So solar cells would play a very crucial role at the beginning stages of our industrialization. So but the consequence of it, like even if you take the solar power on the surface, as in like how much power sun is depositing on the surface, is quite high. Like it's very high. Let's say for instance it's 100 watt per meter square or 1 kilowatt per meter square. Now you can't actually extract that much power, not because physics does not allow you, simply because solar cells work at a very specific frequency of light. Basically, they cannot use the entire electromagnetic spectrum. They can only use from a little bit of infrared to a little bit of ultraviolet. Till this range is their optimum zone. Now we are trying to make a solar cell that can go there, but ends up losing a lot of blue light. We are trying to make something that can handle a lot of ultraviolet, but we end up losing infrared. For this reason, we can't really make a solar cell that in principle can absorb very large chunk of the spectrum. So even though there is a, let's say, 1 kilowatt per meter square, you will barely get half kilowatt, barely. And the solar cell that we have right now that achieve 50% efficiency, they are complex beyond all belief. Like the amount of elements they put into it, it's not as like, oh, it's a silicon thing. No, they're like niobium, chromium, and like things that I can't even understand. There are like a lot of complications that go into making those very high efficiency. For like even these are not that efficient. So practically for surface use, we use solar panels that are only 20% efficient, and on a large scale, that's the only thing that we can mass produce. And if you want to mass produce something like this, if you have to make it on lunar surface itself, it's not a good idea, simply because all the designs that I have seen that use the regolith itself to make the solar cell, they're not very efficient. Their efficiency goes down to 5%. Now, benefit of that, because you have so much surface area and you don't have to worry about clouds and things of that nature, you will still get a lot of power, but it's wasteful based on area. So be mindful, moon has a limited area. It's not infinite size. It has a limited area. So solar panels are a good starting point. But now we come to the cream of the crop, basically solar thermal. Now, solar thermals have very serious consequences. First consequence is very complex. However, and it also has moving parts, as you can see in this. Now, the benefit of that, it is the most powerful. Basically, if you have 1 kilowatt per meter square, you can extract upwards of 0.8 kilowatt using this technology. Now, you might be like, okay, if it is that efficient, why we don't use it on Earth? A, we use them, but B, problem is this requires temperature gradient. Now, the temperature gradient that would be a problem for solar cells becomes a gift for this, because it uses what we call Stirling engine. You can check my video on that. And now Stirling engines really thrive if you have a temperature gradient. Here we don't have temperature gradient on Earth's atmosphere, so they need radiator fans trying to cool it down. Now imagine having radiator fins. This is radiator fins of ISS. Yes, in space you are more likely to roast yourself to death than you to freeze to death. I have no idea why science fiction still shows like people are shivering in cold. You're gonna roast yourself to death. And ISS spends a lot of energy trying to cool itself, so it needs radiator. Now radiator will be placed not on the front, of course on the back side of the dish, and that way you can utilize the fact that you on the one side you can get it as hot as you want. Now ideally you want to be below the melting temperature of the metal you are using. So let's say it's aluminum, you want to be below, let's say, 800 degrees Celsius, 600, let's say, for practical safety reason. And then on the cold end, because you have minus 150 degrees Celsius wherever there is a shade on moon, you can really allow Stirling engine to perform. Like it can really perform and properly utilize the temperature gradient. Solar cells cannot utilize this gradient. And not to mention, this dish can be simply made out of aluminum. You don't need anything fancy out of it, like including this engine. There is nothing complex in this. Like when I say complex, I mean physically complex. It's not like, okay, it's a, just a sheet. Now in solar cell, it's complex in terms of manufacturing, but the implementation is very simple. This can be made, you know, we've been making this sort of technology for 100 years on Earth itself, like early solar dishes and all that. Of course, they were not very efficient, but with modern technology, we can make this. So if you start mining moon and you start getting metals out of it, you don't even need steam. Because moon has low gravity and a lack of oxygen makes sure that even if you use iron, not steel, or iron itself, your structure will last very long time without you having to worry about things like oxidation and other things of that nature. So using this solar dish, and these can be made mobile, and it has to be mobile. Now it generally uses a Stirling engine. Now Stirling engine means there is an AC power. It has another benefit. Now we're gonna use what we call high frequency Stirling engine. The reason for that will become very clear when I talk about the grid aspect of it. But we want to aim for 300 hertz. As many of you know, 300 hertz is common frequency for aircraft industry, and your home industry generally basically runs on 50 or 60 hertz depending on your location. So when we are talking about those sort of thing, we want a Stirling engine which produces high frequency AC current, and it has to be mobile. Now it has to be mobile because this whole aspect, like, you know, we're gonna land on the pole and we're gonna, you know, extract the resources there. Yeah, for how long? If you really want to industrialize the moon, this cannot be a point, because that basically what we call rim of the crater, they're not, you know, super large. They're like, you can get some power out of there, few megawatts, but you're not gonna get gigawatt out of there. So all things considered, we have to expand. Now if we expand, we have to make sure that we can move with the sun. Thankfully, moon rotates very slowly in relative to sun. So you only need to move, let's say, 100 kilometer per day. Per day, so it's per 24 hours, you have to move 100 kilometer, which is very easy. You can literally move it continuously, or you can simply like, okay, the power dish is now shut down. Now you move it to next point, and then you let it roll for another day, and then move. You can keep doing it. Now, if you make high frequency AC, it's very easy to make a high quality DC out of it. Now, this has the idea, the simplest advantage, that this does not require anything fancy. For gas, like for thermal properties of the Stirling engine, we can use hydrogen. Now, hydrogen will not catch on fire because of the vacuum nature of the space itself. So this is why this is crucial. This can extract more power per square meter on the moon, which is limited resource. You don't have infinite amount of it. So this is my personal favorite. Now, how are we going to transfer that energy to wherever we need to? We're going to need to set up a grid. Now, grid will be utilizing HVDC. You can check my video that I made yesterday. So the fact is that AC is not a very efficient way. But then why did I talk about making AC, you know, from the generator? The fact is that we don't have the technology to take DC and bump the voltage up. But on AC side, it's super easy. A transformer is a very simple device. Now, if we use high frequency, we can get a very clean DC out while using normal bridge rectifiers. Now, generally, HVDC that we use on Earth, they use 6-pole system. But we can bypass the need of 6-pole by simply using the fact a high frequency generator, because a full bridge rectifier directly multiplies it by 2. So if you have one phase that is producing 300 hertz, so a full bridge rectifier will invert the bottom frequency to top, and you will end up getting basically 600 peaks in 1 second. So that will allow you to properly boost up the voltage, and while you're converting that boosted voltage to DC, you will get a smooth output. Because if you don't have that smooth output at ultra high voltage, those output require a capacitor that are size of the freaking building. So because of using high frequency, the transformer is smaller, and because of high frequency, we can make cleaner DC. DC voltage is the best way to power supply. Now, why DC? Very simple, because we want to bury the cable. Now, if you bury the cable temperature will go down as close to as minus 150 degrees Celsius. Now, at that temperature, either copper or aluminum, most likely we're gonna use aluminum because there are more aluminum in moon than copper. It starts to behave like a superconductor, not a complete superconductor. Do not think that it has zero resistance, but its resistance goes down considerably at minus 150 degrees Celsius. And even if it doesn't go down, it cannot heat up. Like, let's say you rated the cable for, let's say, 3000 amps. if you send let's say 3500 amps, the temperature rise won't be that dramatic simply because it's in a cold environment. Of course, it's going to radiate heat, and depending on how good the infrared absorption in the nearby area, it will either get hot or cold. So we can bury it. An AC current does not like to be buried. My last episode should have made that clear. Now we're gonna loop it around the grid itself. We're gonna loop it around the pole. Basically, we'll start from pole and we keep looping it around. And at the end, we'll end up with equator. This way, you can be, it will, from our vantage point, from Earth, it will look like there is shining mirrors that are moving, you know, on the surface of moon. This way we can harness much larger power that we need for industrialization. And I'm talking colonizing Venus. That's gonna take hundreds and thousands of tons of aluminum mirrors. So if we want to do this, we need power. So creating that kind of power, we need to utilize the asset properly, basically the surface area. So using solar dishes, we can utilize that area much more effectively. Using the fact that it's creating high frequency AC, we can convert that into proper high voltage DC much more easily. Because it's a DC line, we can bury it. Because of the lower temperature, we can transfer the power hundreds of kilometers, like from here to here, much more effectively. So all things considered, this will be the backbone of our lunar industrial complex. So this way we can get 24/7 power, because that whole idea that that top of that crater has 24/7 power. Yes, but is everybody's gonna fight for that? Like, do you really want to fight for it 24/7? Like, okay, that place, because that place will become very debated between China and America. So if you can create a loop around the moon, and you don't need to create a loop around the equator, you can just start small. You can just start small, and at the early time you will need to move barely, let's say 100 kilometer a day. So you will move 100 kilometer to here. Now you have to wait 15 days till you have to move again. So at the early days, this is very easy. As we technology progresses, we can improve this by paving the road. Basically, you might be like, why we need to pave that again? Because the units are moving, making a road will make it our life easier, make sure the wheels will last longer. And to make the road itself, all you have to do is just make the solar dish focus on the road. It will melt that regolith. You need a temperature upwards of around 1500 degrees Celsius, and it will create basically something equivalent of volcanic glass. So on top of that, you can easily transfer without wasting too much energy. So we'll have a grid, we'll have solar thermal, and then we can truly start this sort of manufacturing. And this will be done underground. That's why we want to make the bury the power cable also, because we have to be underground, because that temperature gradient that makes Stirling engine work effectively will destroy all the machinery that we have on top of the surface. So this was my presentation on Moon Part 2, basically power on the moon. I hope you liked it or learned from it. In that case, please leave a like. If you didn't, don't worry about it, dislike it. I would ask you to leave a comment, share it amongst your friends, and please subscribe. If you are free, press the bell icon. And as always, thanks for watching.